Thank you for joining me, Mr. Dadson, with yet another awesome pre-lab discussion. The next installment, if you will, experiment number 7, thermodynamics of cobalt complexation. Which, by the way, is yet another badass experiment you're missing out on because of the COVID-19 quarantine. Man, am I bitter about that. What about you? Back to it. Here, we will be finding ourselves studying the thermodynamics of an equilibrium process between the aqueous cobalt II cation and the chloride anion. It's actually really cool chemistry. The hexa-aqua cobalt II cation will undergo a reaction with chloride to form the tetrachlorocobaltate anion. Now, that in itself isn't very exciting. It is measurement of the thermodynamic functions that makes us a good time. We'll find ourselves measuring the standard molar enthalpy, that is, delta H, the standard molar entropy, delta S, and along the way, as you would expect, the standard molar free energy, delta G. I have exclamation points for each one of these three objectives because this is a good time. And I know of at least one other person that would agree with me. Boltzmann, what do you think? It's okay. Boltzmann, you suck. Back to it. A spontaneous process is one that takes place without assistance from the surroundings. Kind of like a ball rolling down the hill. It's just going to happen. And we have a number of chemical reactions that occur spontaneously. The spontaneity of these chemical processes is determined by the enthalpy change and the entropy change, delta H and delta S. We're, of course, as chemists, we would find ourselves predicting that spontaneity with the use of Gibbs free energy change, delta G. Where delta G, our free energy change, is calculated from the enthalpy and entropy changes using the equation which appears on the screen now. I would say larger than life equation, but as you can see, it's barely larger than the font that already appears on the screen. We can modify this expression slightly in the discussion of standard states. If at standard conditions, one molarity and one atmosphere, we might write the expression slightly differently by including that superscript O to the right of our letters. It simply implies standard. Moving forward, it's worthwhile to note that the standard free energy change can be related to the equilibrium constant using the equation that appears on the screen. For R is your familiar universal gas constant, 8.314 joules per mole Kelvin, and the temperature, T, is obviously in Kelvin. For this experiment, we'll find ourselves measuring the equilibrium constant at different temperatures of T. Based on those different values of K that we calculate, we'll determine different values for the standard free energy change. Then, with knowledge of the free energy change for the different temperatures, we'll determine the enthalpy change and the entropy change for this process. All in all, a good time. Again, worthy the exclamation point, even if Boltzmann disagrees. So, some basic chemistry. The cobalt II cation, like all metal cations, will find itself reacting with water in the aqueous phase. In the case of cobalt II, we see the formation of hexa-aqua cobalt II, an octahedral complex. That octahedral complex, of course, will see the resultant splitting of the d orbitals. Cobalt 2 has 7 d electrons, which might populate the d orbitals as seen on the screen. Take note of the fact that the splitting energy is relatively large, giving rise to the absorption of visible light of about 500 nanometers. Using our color wheel, we might predict a complementary color that's observed of pink for that hexa-aqua cobalt complex. Now for the chemistry. In hydrochloric acid at relatively high concentrations, that chloride anion will replace the water in our complex to form the tetrachlorocobaltate II complex, which, if you haven't noticed yet, is tetrahedral, not octahedral. And that tetrahedral complex is expected to have a much smaller splitting energy, which increases the magnetism of the complex, but more importantly, changes the wavelength of light being absorbed. The small splitting energy gives rise to the absorption of light with less energy, light more towards the red end of the visible spectrum, which means this particular complex will be blue in color. Again, fun times. We expect a pink color for the hexa-aqua-cobalt complex, a blue color for the tetrachlorocobaltate II complex. And of course, as you might expect, given the enthalpy change, when we change the temperature of the system, we'll change the equilibrium position, which gives rise to a change in color. And that, of course, is the basis for this experiment. These two complexes absorb at different wavelengths, which means if I happen to have both present in the same aqueous solution, I might expect to see an absorption at different wavelengths, again for each of those two complexes. An absorption at around 500 nanometers for the aqua complex, an absorption around 690 nanometers for the chloride complex. Now that absorption will obviously depend on the concentration of those complexes. And of course, we expect those concentrations to change with a change in temperature. And as such, we expect to see the absorbance for each of these two complexes to change with temperature, such that perhaps with an increase in temperature, I might expect to see the concentration of the aqua complex decrease and the concentration of the chloro complex increase. And of course, with even a higher temperature yet, an even lower concentration of the water aqua complex, and an even higher concentration of the chloride. In this experiment, we'll find ourselves measuring the absorbance of the tetrachlorocobaltate complex at different temperatures, allowing us to determine the equilibrium constant of the different temperatures. Once we have the equilibrium constants for different temperatures, we then go about having our fun. We'll first begin by calculating the free energy change for each of those different temperatures based on that equilibrium constant K. Next, we'll find ourselves determining the enthalpy and entropy change. This is simple enough. We imagine ourselves rearranging the expression we've learned about thus far. Instead of writing delta G equals delta H minus T delta S, I would write delta G equals negative delta ST plus delta H. And in this form, we can almost imagine the Y equals MX plus B. That is, I can plot the standard free energy change on the Y-axis versus the temperature on the x-axis. For the intercept is delta H, our enthalpy change, here 45.6, same units as the free energy change, and therefore kilojoules per mole, and the slope, well, the negative of the slope is the entropy, in the same units as the free energy, multiply by 1,000, and you obtain 64.9 joules per mole Kelvin. And that, of course, is the experiment in a nutshell. I hope you found this enjoyable. Lord knows, I had a great time myself.